none of you suffer as an evildoer, or as a thief, or as a murderer, or as an evil, as a thief, or as a evildoer. Yeah, or as busybodies in other men's matters. In other men's matter. I can't. It's hard at the end of the day on Sundays. I'll tell you what. I can know it just perfectly. These are scripture memory for last. We're doing the scripture memory challenge for last Sunday. Brother Chuck, what was the verse that you did last week? Yours was a commonly known one, right? I'm trying to remember what it was. I can look it up. My phone died before the service. Hey, wait. No, don't have it here. It's in the other room. Remember what you learned last week, Chuck? Well, then why do I have to? I know it. Let me find it. Anybody have any scripture memory cards while I'm moving this way? You have one, Chuck?
Yeah. All right.
To meditate on a scripture, and it's sort of like a little sermonette, you know, you could, if you imagine, from you. You know, that not suffering as a busybody in other men's matters, you know, that's a real help, you know. Charlie, do I get in your business a little bit too much? Oh, okay. I've been wondering about it. I've been thinking, man, did Charlie come with that verse? Is he on me for something? But it was Lee and his family that quoted that one. So, anyway, I greatly enjoy them and encourage you to memorize the scripture. The truth is that I could memorize scripture on my own, but I think it's a fun way for us to all memorize scripture, and it's a challenge. It's good to be challenged as a believer. I've been kind of meditating today on our text in Hebrews 10 and the use of the word provoke, to provoke one another unto love and good works. And literally the word provoke is synonymous with irritate. And sometimes being told that we ought to do something kind of irritates us a little bit. Sometimes we don't want to hear that we're wrong or that we ought to get right, but it's good for us and we need to provoke each other in a good way. Mm-hmm. It's one of the few instances in the scripture where provoke is I think the only instance in the scripture when provoke is used in a positive way. And so it helps me to understand that the word really is appropriately used as an irritant. And so it helps you. But brethren, if you try to help a believer get right and they get mad at you, you must be doing a good job provoking them to good works. If you do it in a spirit of love. I mean, it's a little ironic, but there is a serious aspect. Sometimes we've got such a thin skin about how we're received when we do right. But the truth is, it's more important to do right, regardless of how you're received. You have a good spirit about it, and if it provokes people, or if they're irritated by your trying to do right by them, then that's just the way it has to be. I can think of only a few occasions in my life where, as a Christian brother, I've had to take the scripture and go to another brother and say, well, this is what the Word of God says, and have them happily receive it. But I can think of many instances where it has been received. Many instances where it's been received. And that's a help. So, it's just another instance of a verse of the scripture that just gets in your mind and has application. Isn't our context this evening? We're in Revelation chapter 2. And we're in Thyatira this evening. Verse 18 of Revelation 2. And unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works, and charity, and service, and faith, and thy patience, and thy works. And the last to be more than the first. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication. She repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and hearts. And I will give unto every one of you according to your works. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden, but that which ye have already. Hold fast till I come. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father, and I will give him the morning star. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Our Father, I pray that you would help us both with understanding this evening as well, Lord, with the practical living of the things that we understand. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let's do a little bit of review. We're several weeks in now into Revelation. You tell me why it is that it's important for us to study and to read and to apply Revelation. Yeah, the Scripture says there's a specific blessing. Chapter 1 and verse 3 says, "Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand." Now that is not three separate categories. That's a qualification for every category. In other words, the person who's blessed is a person that reads, and that hears, and that obeys or keeps the words of the prophecy. And the reason? Time is at hand. So there's a blessing for those that study Revelation. I don't know about you, but when we're talking about God blessing us, I'm all in. I want it. I want God's blessing in my life. Don't you? Sometimes I'm jealous of God's blessing. Are you ever? You ever, or I should say, the word jealous is perhaps not the correct term, but sometimes I desire God's blessing. Sometimes I read about the benefits of Israel, and I think, man, I wish I was a legitimate Israelite and knew what my tribe were and all of these things and had the blessings that God has for them. As I study the New Testament of the Scripture, it's apparent, the Scripture plainly lays forth that we are Jews, and I'm actually found out my tribe. You know what tribe I am? What? Judah. I'm of the tribe of Judah. Because I'm covered by the blood of Jesus Christ, and I have His position. I have His position as a son. So you want to know what tribe I'm from? I found out I'm from the tribe of Judah. It took me a long time. Sometimes, you know, I don't catch on very quickly. It took me a long time to realize that, but that's my tribe because I was adopted and I have the position of Jesus Christ. The Bible says I'm a Jew indeed. I'm a legitimate deal. And thank God for that. That's not replacement theology. That God has a future plan for Israel, but I have a future place in Christ's millennial kingdom. Okay, grammatically speaking, you tell me about the outline of Revelation. It's in the introduction, but what's the outline of Revelation?
What's past, what's present, what's to come?
Yeah. Verse 19 of Revelation 1 gives us the outline. It's interesting, almost all of the Scripture, if you've ever taken the time to actually outline a book of the Bible, if you haven't, this would be a good Bible study practice for you. Take a second here and talk about it. It's a real good practice when you're studying the Scripture to actually take the Scripture and put it in outline, put it in points. And you have an introduction in every portion of the Scripture. And the introduction always tells you, what does a good introduction do? Well, it tells, it introduces the material, and then it tells you what it's going to say. And so the introduction in Revelation chapter 1 in verse 19 tells us what's going to be written. The things which thou hast seen, so past, the things which are present, and the things which shall be hereafter. Now the things which thou hast seen, this is what's in the material up to verse 19. How that the John is in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and the Son of Man appears to him, And he's sitting in the midst of the churches, in the midst of the seven candlesticks. And that's the past. That's the things that John had already seen. The things which are, and that's the things that are to the churches. And interestingly enough, as we end chapter 4 and the church at Laodicea, we never find the church again mentioned in the entirety of Revelation. Church is gone after chapter 3. Why is that, you ask? Well, because the events following chapter 3 don't involve the church. She's not there in those events. And so that's an important truth as you study the Revelation. And so they're future events. They're events that are in the future. Now, having said that then, the portion of the Scripture we're in right now, which is the letters to the churches, has direct application today. I've heard teaching, and I'm not opposed to it. I don't think it's wrong, but I've heard teaching that each of the churches represents an age of the church, and the people that teach that would teach that we're in the Thyatira age and beginning the Laodicean era of the church. I don't think that that is false teaching. I don't think it's wrong. I believe historically there's an uncanny, uncanny semblance. There's an uncanny resemblance, but I will say that would make the things which are the things which were. And that isn't so yet because we're still in the church age. You understand that? So these churches are real churches. We know how the church at Ephesus came to be, for instance. We know the history of a lot of these churches. And so we know that these letters to the church have characteristics that apply to any church. Keep in mind as we study through Revelation that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. Most prophetic study is a waste of time. Did you hear me? Most prophecy study is a time waster. In other words, it is people speculating what events mean. A lot of people spend time, well, you know, right now we've got Donald Trump and we've got Hillary Clinton and we've got Vladimir Putin. Where do they fit in Revelation? Well, they fit in Romans 3:23. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. They belong in Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. They belong in John chapter 3. How can these things be? As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's where those folks belong. Man, if you get a chance to shake Donald Trump's hand, tell him he needs to trust Jesus as his Savior. If you get a chance to, I don't know what you'd be doing around Hillary. She'd probably slap you if you got within touching distance. But if you get a chance to come around Hillary, tell her the gospel and that she can be saved. If you get a chance to meet Vladimir Putin, do the same. You know, give the gospel in Russian. That's what these guys need. As far as their significance in prophetic events, Jesus said to his disciples when they said, "When shall these things be?" He said, "Ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars." And he said, "See that ye be not troubled, for the end is not yet." The reality is that current events today are strikingly similar to the turmoil that the world was in during the time that Revelation was written. The world was a powder keg. Rome's grip on the world was still strong and still aggressively having its effect, but Rome was in turmoil and the nations of the world were going out and battling each other, and there were wars and rumors of wars. Truthfully, Jerusalem was about to be sacked. The events that happened in 70 AD were about to take place, and there was serious trouble in the world. And so if you'd asked anybody of that day whether or not it looked like the end times, the answer would have been just what Jesus said. No man knoweth the day or the hour. And if you think that events somehow control the coming of Jesus, my friend, Jesus said the Son of Man doesn't know the day or the hour that He's coming. And so we see those questions answered. Mark chapter 13 answers the questions Matthew 24, 25 answers a lot of those questions. And they're very, very plain if you will study them in grammatical context. Incidentally, today, there is a recurring fad. It happens about every 20 or 30 years. Recurring fad to play around with dispensational theology and to say, well, the next event isn't Jesus Christ coming. The next event's the tribulation. And friend, if you'll study the scripture, first of all, that flies in the face of a good grammatical outline of Mark 13 and Matthew 24. It's absolutely impossible to take what Jesus has said in the way that he said it, even in 2 Thessalonians 4 and 5 as well. It's impossible to deny that the Lord Jesus is coming at any time. See, the imminence of the Lord's coming, my friend, is something we're commanded to pray for. Amen. We're supposed to love His returning, love His coming. And I promise you, if Jesus were coming to bring tribulation and trouble onto the earth, we wouldn't love His coming. The righteous have never had judgment impending for them. Judgment has never been for the righteous. Judgment has always been for the wicked. And I'm not talking about judgment in the sense of reward. I'm talking about judgment in the sense of destroying the wicked. And the events of the tribulation are for the wicked. They are a judgment on the world for a response to Jesus. And at the time that the tribulation has happened, Jesus has called up His church. And that is why in Revelation, you never see a mention after the church is addressed, you never see a mention of the church again. All the New Testament is about the church, about the new covenant. But after Revelation 4, you never see a mention of the church. You see a mention of the whore, Babylon. You see a mention of those that say they are Jews and are not. But you never find Christ's church. Doesn't occur after Revelation 4. Well, let's talk about Thyatira tonight, shall we? Every single one of the churches has characteristics. And it begins with the Lord representing Himself to the church. In verse 18, the representation of Jesus to the church is, "These things saith the Son of God, who hath His eyes like unto a flame of fire, and His feet are like fine brass." Well, this is a reference to the truth. This is a reference just like we see in chapter 1 in verses 14 and 15. The Bible says, "His head and His hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and His eyes were as a flame of fire, and His feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and His voice as the sound of many waters." The picture here we find of the Son of Man is not the meek and lowly shepherd. The picture we see of the Son of Man here is the righteous judge of the world. And as the church is being referred to, they're being reminded that Jesus is a righteous, holy God. And that though He is the representation of God's love, He will also be the one who is physically executing God's wrath. Friend, you and I ought to have a balanced understanding of God's love and His holiness. We ought to understand that God is both love and God is holy, and we ought to have a reverential approach to God. It literally will break you down when you realize how much God loves you. The love, the goodness of God, the Bible says, leadeth thee to repentance. And the fear of God leadeth thee to repentance as well. They're balanced attributes of God. And my friend, God is 100% love. And He's also 100% judgment. God is not partially anything. God isn't, you know, I'm love until it gets to this level and then I get ticked off. And then I become wrath. No, my friend, God's wrath is complete. He's completely a God of wrath. And for any person who wants to face God for judgment, they will be completely destroyed by God's wrath. God is completely love. And for any person who comes to God through the love that is demonstrated by the blood of His Son, that person is completely covered by God's love. We don't go to heaven and get purgatory or purged. We don't, heaven isn't a, you know, it's not a purging experience where we go to heaven and God says, yeah, I'm going to have to squeeze you a little bit. You weren't as good a Christian as you ought to have been. No, we're completely justified. You don't get to hell and God say, well, you could have been worse. You're a little bit good. And so mostly wrath, but I'll be a little bit gentle. A little bit of my mercy and love. No, my friend, you'll get God's wrath or you'll get God's mercy. Either or, and it'll be 100% of your perspective of God. This church at Thyatira has a makeup that will receive one or the other. Either God's wrath or God's mercy. Let's look at it. In verse 19, Jesus said the same thing that He says to every church. He said, I know thy works. And He said that to every church. I know thy works. I know thy works. And so, He's making sure that they know that God knows. And many times that's very, very a very comforting statement. It's a comforting thing. And so, in this instance, He said, I know thy works and I know thy charity and service and faith and thy patience and thy works. Was that mentioned before?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so the Scripture's not reading it off the way that I read it. You know, and thy charity and thy patience and, you know, thy faith and thy works. No, every one of those is important, but the emphasis here is that this church at Thyatira is a working church. The emphasis here, and the Bible says in the former, or the last to be more than the first. And this is a fascinating commentary on this church, and oh, am I ever proud of it. I liken this church to, this is how I see it in my mind. Years ago, when I was in college, long time ago, in 98, when my sister, now it'd be 99, here we go, 1999, my sister had graduated from college and she got her first job at Jostens Yearbook Company in Topeka. And so she relocated to there. She would have been 21, I think. She just finished college and my mom and dad said, okay, you're done with college. Go get a job. Get out of the house. And so she did. She got a job. And she got a job at Jostens, a nice job. And so she moved to Topeka. My mom and dad helped her find an apartment, get her located. And she got a job at this yearbook company doing art for them. And so she had to find a church, and she did. I don't remember the name of the church. I could remember if I needed to, but I don't remember it. I don't need to. And she found a church, and they had a pastor who was about 80. And he had just retired. He just resigned as pastor, and he felt like the church needed a younger man that would be able to help grow the ministry. The church had kind of diminished a little bit. Matter of fact, it diminished so much they had nice property. They formerly had a Christian school, but they had all the property there and everything was still in nice shape, but they only had about 13 people going to church there. I was in Christian college. I was a Bible major, and so they would have me come up and preach pretty often in the summertime. So, I don't know, 3-4 times in a summer, I would go to Topeka, my sister's church, and I would preach for them. And they actually asked me, you know, would you consider candidating here? Would you consider being, you know, pastor of this church? And the Lord never led that way. Back in, my sister got married in 2002, moved away from there. And in 2000, and so that would be about 4 years that they needed a pastor. 2010. I was passing through Topeka on a Sunday night, and I always go to church if I'm on the road. I had to go to, what was the year your grandpa was sick and my dad had his surgery? Would that be 10? Okay, 2010. I had to go pick up Melissa in Arkansas. My dad had had a surgery in Kansas, so I'd been there with him. And I was on my way to Arkansas to pick her up and to come back down here. I stopped by that church. So that would have been 12 years. And I went to that church. The pastor who had formerly been there no longer was alive, no longer living. But the same 13 people were there on Sunday night. And my heart broke for them, honestly. The church was in about the same condition. The facilities were still in the same kind of condition. The same guy was leading the singing. Same family was there playing the piano and the organ. Same young, they had a couple young people, you know. By that, they had been in their late teens, and now they're in their, you know, late 20s. And they're still there. But mostly it was just a couple of the older folks that had been there a long time. And as far as I know, today that church still doesn't have a pastor and is still doing the same as they were then. But I know this about those people there. If the Lord tarries, they'll be faithful in that ministry until they die. No question in my mind, I could go there 20 years from now. If they're still alive, they're still physically able to do so, they'll still be in that church. By the way, it's the best church in town. Not that it'd be a good place for somebody to plant a church. Go and pastor that church. But they'll be there if the Lord tarries. And when I see the scripture in Thyatira saying, I know thy works, and the last more than the first, I think of the faithfulness of these folks in Thyatira, and I think that they must have, the idea here isn't that the first works were less important or had less depth. But the emphasis here is that they never stopped. In other words, God says, I know how you ended more than I know how you began. And this is an impressive indictment from the Lord Almighty, my friend. This is an impressive take. You give me someone not who is going to do something. I'm always excited when somebody's going to do something. You know how many people are going to come to church? You know how many people are going to get baptized? You know how many people are going to grow and become Sunday school teachers? Do you know how many people are going to whatever for the Lord? I'm always excited that people are going to do something, but I'm always a little bit reserved in my excitement. Not because I'm a skeptic, but because I'm experienced. And I know that a lot of people lie to God about what they're going to do. And I don't know any kinder, gentler terms to put it in, but it's simply put, they promise God they'd do a thing and they don't do it. And that happens far more frequently than people to do what they claim that they're going to do or what they promise God they're going to do. But it is something thrilling about a person who begins and continues, and far more thrilling, finishes. Lee, what was the last verse your granddad said? What was the scripture that he quoted before he went to heaven? Was it, I've fought a good fight, I've finished the course, I've kept the faith? Was that his scripture? Or is that the one I gave him? What? Isaiah 4. Oh, yeah. They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And for Maynard Riffle, Lee's granddad, to say something like that, if you knew him, you'd just say, finisher. He's a guy that started well, continued well, and finished well. You never wonder, I wonder if Maynard's still going to church. I wonder if he's still working in Awanas. I wonder if he's still as solid doctrinally as he's ever been. I wonder if he's still a good husband. I wonder if he's still a good granddad. I wonder if he's still a good father. You just knew, based on watching the man. You know, it was funny because when I worked in the shop, there were people that worked there, and they were all ages all the way up into like about 50 when I would have been, you know, 19 or 20. And everybody there had had Maynard take them to Awana Club. You got a guy that's 50, and yeah, Maynard taught me when I was a kid. You got a guy that's 45, yeah, Maynard taught me when I was a kid. You got a guy that's 35, yeah, Maynard used to pick me up and take me to church. You know, and then on Wednesday nights, you had kids showing up and Maynard taking them to church. He always worked with kids. Always cared about teaching them Scripture and working with the Awanas. Just, that was just what he always did. And he finished loving the Lord and having that same faithful testimony he always had. That's Thyatira. This is a church of people that started well, they do the works, they have charity, they have faith, they have patience, and they finish. And I'm just telling you something, you're going to give me a badge or give me a medal for finishing. I'm not impressed by, and I think God is certainly less impressed by, anybody who begins something and quits. And these people aren't quitters. They're a group of people that said, you know what? We know God. We know what God can do. And we believe God. And we're not quitting. And they didn't. God said, I know about that. But then he mentioned the standing or the things that weren't okay. There he said, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and eat things sacrificed to idols. This is a parallel to the indictment in verse 14 of the church of Pergamos. They said they have the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel to eat things sacrificed unto idols and to commit fornication. Now, what is the difference between Balaam and Jezebel in these instances?
Both bad people.
Huh? Well, they're both bad people, so that would be a similarity, not a difference. There's no difference in the outcome, is there? No. The outcome is that they eat things sacrificed unto idols and they commit fornication. Isn't it funny when you hear Christian Liberty preach from Romans? How they say, well, it's okay to eat things offered to idols because it's Christian liberty. Those people, that's the only verse in the Bible they know. They know they got their little sermon on Christian liberty, but they never read Acts 15. They sure never read Revelation chapter 2. God hates things offered to idols. He hates the idea of it. And it isn't in our liberty. That's the things we're supposed to abstain from, things strangled and meat offered to idols in Acts 15. So, read your whole Bible before you go off on a tangent and become all about one teaching that isn't actually what's being taught in those places. That isn't Christian liberty, my friend. It isn't just because of your brother. It's not because your brother's offended by it. It's because Jesus is offended by it. You get that? And we as believers seem to think God doesn't have an opinion. It's just people that do. But you better search and find out whether or not it's God's opinion, whether or not you'd be embarrassed to do it in front of Jesus rather than in front of pastor or somebody else. Okay. What's the difference between the Balaam and Jezebel? Well, the outcome's the same, isn't it? I think the difference is methodology. How did Balaam advise Balak? What was his advice to Balak?
Get them to sin by getting them to eat the sacrifices of the dead or something.
Yeah, basically make a stumbling block for them. In other words, get them
sin.
Get them to the appeal of the idolatry of the land to appeal to the children of Israel. And when that happens, then God won't bless them. You just get them to sin against God, and God will judge them. That was Balaam's tactic. What's Jezebel's tactic? Well, it's almost the same, except it's just more about following me. In other words, the one is about, do this. This is the method to cause them to sin. But in this church at Thyatira, there is a Jezebel, a person. She said, I'm a prophetess. And she's the, follow me. It's about me. It's the leadership. It's the leadership that's a stumbling blocker that leads people into sin. And so it's the same outcome. I mean, eating meat offered to idols and so forth, those things are the same, whether whatever the method is, but Jezebel is the attraction on the one versus the sin being the attraction on the other. So it's just a different tactic of Satan. One maybe doesn't work, so maybe the other one will. Or, you know, whatever. But it's a parallelism. It's a parallel to the same judgment. Fornication and things sacrificed to idols. In verse 21, we see this fornication being very specific. And friend, let me just tell you this. I do believe that the Jezebel referred to is the Jezebel of the Old Testament. I also believe that she's a specific woman at Thyatira. I think she's a Jezebel of a true type, true form. God said, verse 21, I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. She's a woman who evidently has an appeal. You ever think about Jezebel? I mean, she just seems like a witch, doesn't she, in the Old Testament? I mean, do you know that woman had to have been so beautiful? She had to have been so beautiful to be able to... She just couldn't have been ugly and been as nasty as she was. You have to be beautiful to be that mean. You know? You ever met a woman that was beautiful and you found out, boy, that's an ugly person. But it was just because... And how in the world would anyone follow them? How in the world would anyone succumb to their wiles? Well, she must have had a real seductive beauty. And that's the idea of this woman here, and the idea of the fornication here, is that she is so attractive that she can get people to do things that are morally against their conscience, and yet somehow she just has this allure to her. And she's able to be in this. She says, I'm a prophetess. I'm a child of God. God said, I gave her space to repent. She repented not. He said, I'll cast her into a bed. And then they commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And so here's a specific warning that if you don't separate from her, you'll go down with her. Here's a woman who's in the church, and her doctrine, which she's teaching. She says, I'm a prophetess, and the doctrine that this prophet teaches in the church is fornication and sacrifice to idols. Is she a believer?
Nope.
She's a plant. She's an unbeliever that's planted there by Satan. Friend, you and I have to be very well aware the same thing can happen in our churches. Too often in the church, fornication is permitted. Too often it happens and people wink or look the other way or think, well, you know, it's good people that are involved in it. And it isn't so, my friend. It's a Jezebel. It's a wicked thing, and the church had better separate from it. Better cast it out. Anybody that gets involved with it will be destroyed. In verse 24, we see that not everybody fits in this category. Unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden. These faithful individuals at Thyatira have an unfaithful individual in their midst. And God's direct word is, I'm going to destroy that wicked person. She's going through the tribulation. She's going to be destroyed. But His response to those who are not involved in it is, but that's not for you. That which you already have, hold fast till I come. Again, this idea of you're doing, I know your works, and that the latter, the last is more than the first. God says, I know that. I know you're not involved with it. I know this isn't you. I know that you're faithful. That which ye have already, hold fast till I come. Just remain faithful. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. Is that a wonderful promise or isn't it? Let me ask you a practical question. If this is written only to the church at Thyatira, how many of them lasted until the end? Or someone that wants to say, oh, it's only written to one specific church. It's not written to the church. How many lasted until the end? Every one of them was dead. So were there none faithful there? Or is the scripture indicating something other? That latter is true, isn't it? Okay, and verse 27 is a reference to the reign of Jesus Christ. He shall rule them, speaking of the power of the nations. He that overcometh keepeth my works unto the end. To him will I give power over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. As the vessels of potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. Now, is this speaking of Christians being faithful to God through the tribulation? Well, it would be a little sad for the poor folks that were at Thyatira at the time, because just because they didn't live long enough, they got excluded. You understand that? And so this is a reference to our coming with the Lord Jesus Christ to rule and reign on the earth. It's fascinating when you study Ezekiel 37, I believe it is, and when you study Daniel and you look at the inheritance that the Gentiles have and the role that we have. My friend, I'm just telling you something. This is a literal reign that Jesus Christ is going to rule. And we're literally going to reign with the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to be among the faithful. Don't you?
Amen.
You don't want to take these scriptures out of context and take the promise out of them. If you do that, you take the promise out of them. This is one of the blessings for those that are faithful. God said, I'll give him the morning star. I don't know exactly what that means. If somebody tells you that they do, they're lying to you. God will give it to you, though. It's a reward. It's a reward for the faithful. It's another promise of God's blessing. This is not a reference to Satan. God isn't going to give you your own personal devil, you know. Similar to the promise to the church at Pergamos, where God said, I'm going to write your name, and it's going to be a secret name. Give him a name. And this is, I want to give him a morning star. In other words, a memento of your faithfulness. It'd be kind of cool if it was a literal star. It could be. It'd be kind of neat if it was a sun or something like that. And God says, it's your own private star in the solar system, you know. Have to take it back from these people that are registering stars and other people's names for Christmas gifts and so forth. Sorry, that one's mine. I gave it to Jesus. Gave it to Ryan, you know. But I want one. Don't you? You know why I want one? Same reason I want a medal. Why would you want a medal?
Because
you don't have one. Because I want to do well. I want to serve the Lord Jesus. And it isn't about having a star. It's about knowing that you did right for the Lord Jesus Christ. Knowing that you were faithful. Friend, I dread the alternative. Don't you? I dread standing before God empty-handed. I dread standing before God and having my works burned, and turns out it was all wood, hay, and stubble, and there's no gold and silver and precious stones. I dread going to the judgment seat and not having a crown. I want some of those crowns. I'll take a martyr's crown if the Lord will give it to me. I want them. Why? Because I want to have something that's worth something. Christian, we need some believers that want to live life like these folks that are faithful in Thyatira, that the end of their works, the last of their works, are better than the first because they're still faithful. And that in spite of all the things, all the turning away and all the generations of failure that they have lasted through, they're still faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ. And God give us a church of people who say, you know something? I want the morning star. If Jesus is going to give out some kind of an award, I don't know exactly what it is, but I want one. If Jesus is going to give a prize, you want it? You want to earn the prize? You do this and you'll get a prize, is what the Bible says. You need to overcome. You need to be faithful to the end. Now let me ask you a question. Is that possible in your strength? Not hardly. But is it possible by God's grace? 100%. Absolutely. And believer, you and I can practice living out the promises that Jesus makes to Thyatira this week and for the rest of our lives. Isn't that good? Isn't God good? Father, thank you for what we've learned tonight. I ask that you would help it to sink into our minds and our hearts. Help us to love it and long for it. We ask in Jesus' name.